Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us. We're here tonight with Representative Erin Grall. She's going to be sharing about the Parents' Bill of Rights. Representative Grall is from District 54, and a few years ago, she created and sponsored the Parents' Bill of Rights, and after 3 years pushing it through legislatively this past session, it passed in the House, it passed in the Senate, and 2 days ago, it was signed by Governor Ron DeSantis. And today, July 1st, Thursday, 2021, the law has become effective as a law for the Parents' Bill of Rights. And we want to welcome Representative Erin Grall.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you for joining us. And we have just a few questions because there's been a huge grassroots effort to support this bill. And we want to thank you for sure that you've led this effort for so many years. And we just want to ask a few questions so we can just help people understand the meaning of the bill, the significance of the bill, and what parents can do now that the bill has passed into law. So just personally, how do you feel about the issue of parental rights and why it's so important?
Well, I think for years now, we've just seen overreach when it comes to the involvement with our families, whether or not it's in the private sector or whether or not it's government. And that overreach needed to be addressed. And so that was really why the Parents' Bill of Rights resounded with me as something that was so important for us to take on and make sure that there was clarity in our statutes and our laws in Florida for those entities to know how they should interact with families. And so it has become a complete passion. I've seen it with my children and just in different areas. I think that there's a lot of sectors in which they take for granted the access to our children, mm-hmm. and then of course with access to our children comes influence over our children. And as parents, we all need to be looking out for that and making sure that we're vigilant in the way that society interacts with our kids.
Absolutely, and I mean, it's important that our society recognize that parents' rights are fundamental and that they have a specific role, but it's never to take the role of a parent. And why do you feel like this bill in particular, now that it's a law, is so strategic right now in our state and even in the nation?
I think that, it's strategic in the way that you see kind of an uprising, I think, of parents who have taken their responsibilities as parents very seriously for years, but and didn't realize maybe the overreach that had been happening in the background until we obviously had seen a little bit more of that overreach over the course of the last year and a half. But for the parents that parents like you and Jim, who were there at the beginning, your daughter Abigail bringing these issues to my attention, the parents who reached out in not only our community and across the state about things that were happening in either school districts or around medical treatment prior to this last year and a half that really were the impetus for the bill originally. I think those issues just were amplified over the course of the last year and a half.
Right.
And so they've existed, this overreach has existed for some time now, and it's parents who take their responsibility so seriously that are really saying, hey, we need to fight back. And that was who I felt like I could be a champion for in this over these last 3 years.
Absolutely. And so, I mean, 3 years ago, 3+ years ago, when you created the bill, we knew it was significant, we knew it was important, we were seeing different overreach in these different areas, but especially in the last year and a half, it's come completely to the forefront, and it seems very timely that we finally have this law passed so that parents can now take that next step and move forward and take the rights back and help these entities understand what their rights are. So in creating it, that was your reason and your purpose behind it.
Definitely, and I think that over the course of 3 years and running a bill for 3 years, each year something new really came to my attention that was happening every day around us. Mm-hmm. Whether or not it was the explosion of mental health services to our children in schools without parental permission, across the board, not necessarily because there was an emergency that had happened or there was a dangerous situation at home, but just across the board mental health services being offered without the input or the direction of the child is something that had come to my attention later in the process. So sometimes it's frustrating how slow the process can be, but it also helps us identify more of the more of the challenges that we're seeing and really the scope of the problem. And the scope of the problem was much more significant, I think, than anybody ever anticipated.
I agree. So why do you think it's so significant for Florida parents and families? What's the law going to do for us? And what will its impact be for Florida families?
I think the law provides a framework for what families can expect in terms of the interaction that their children may have with any governmental entity and even private healthcare providers,
right.
And sets forth the parameters of those relationships and gives the parents some recourse if those relationships are abused, if the overreach exists, and it's really in that recourse, which hopefully, you know, it's always my hope that you don't have to seek recourse under our laws,
mm-hmm.
but that the laws provide such a meaningful framework that lets everybody know what the rules of the road are and how to interact with children and families and how mm-hmm. to put families first. And so that's how I hope that it will work for Florida families.
Right. There's certainly going to be a ripple effect within different entities like public school systems and then other government entities. We've seen that overreach happening. We've seen a lot of pushback going on with that. Do you think they're going to come along and recognize this as law and begin to really truly respect parental rights according to the law?
I think that there are a number of entities that will. I think our school district here in Indian River County has already reached out and they are interested in involving me in the implementation of the Parents'
Good.
Bill of Rights in our
mm-hmm.
school district. I hope that that potentially there will be room for some guidance from the state level for all of the counties
mm-hmm.
and all of the school districts so that we have some uniformity with the way that the bill is implemented. But of course, I expect pushback. After sitting through the committee meetings and the hearings on this issue for the last 3 years, there's pushback from a number of different people or organizations,
mm-hmm.
but I think that pushback is exactly why the bill is so important.
Right, and a lot of that pushback really revolved around the fact that they didn't fully understand the bill or that the lines have been skewed for so long that, you know, we demonstrate the need for the bill in showing that parents actually do have those rights,
yes.
and they weren't not even recognizing the fact that parents have those rights.
Yes.
Yeah. So this law is to bring family back to the forefront and allow parents to begin to step into those places again. There's a simple way of explaining the law. It's 12 pages, okay? One of your shorter bills, obviously.
Yes.
And many times I heard you say in the different committee meetings, like you were concerned that people hadn't even read the bill. And parents, we've tried to simplify that for them in this booklet that we've created, but there's a couple of ways of saying it that why you created it. And it was to bring current laws under one place and then also to establish parental rights as fundamental. Would that be?
Well, I think that, you know, parental rights have been established as fundamental through much case law. That there's
mm-hmm.
been case law that has addressed the issue for a number of years.
Mm-hmm.
I do think that that's important. That's an important foundation
mm-hmm.
to our laws. Case law is a component of it. But it was important that the legislature also reaffirm that commitment
mm-hmm.
through our code, through the statutes.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that to the extent that we were able to do that, it's a huge win for parents and families.
Mm-hmm.
There are also some other areas mm-hmm. that we were able to expand upon in terms of, you know, the role that any governmental entity should have with a child. And so we went so far as to say that if somebody encourages a minor to withhold information from their parents, there can be disciplinary action taken.
Of course, yeah.
And that's not something that necessarily existed before in law, but it is something that there was a lot of controversy around it. And it's my position that no individual should be able to be in a position where they're encouraging or coercing our children
right.
to keep important information from
Absolutely.
Us. And so
mm-hmm.
those were things that were really added to the section around education. You know, there are parental rights established in the education statutes, but there's never really been, it's not been clear the way in which that should be addressed at each school district level, how that information should be shared with parents.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully this will help with that regard. And there was some gray area around medical providers. And obviously we know that medical providers pushed back pretty hard on this bill at the end,
mm-hmm.
But when it went to the governor. And it's because there has been some gray area in that space, mm-hmm. in which, you know, there shouldn't be medical liberties that are taken with our children. Parents should have the ability to be involved with the medical treatment of a child, consent to that treatment. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about children, we're talking about minors. And at the end of the day, the responsibility for that child sits with the parents.
Right.
And so therefore they should be engaged in those conversations and those medical decisions. And so,
yeah.
You know, I think we bring clarity to the medical treatment statutes.
Yeah, and it was kind of interesting to see the fact that the pushback really was based on a misperception,
yes.
about emergency care, and it really has nothing to do with emergency care, because if a child is going to be a part of a sporting program or something like that, they already have to sign a consent, mm-hmm. form. And any kind of emergency care for that child is covered under that consent form. And the medical providers seem to have that as a misunderstanding, or they flat out didn't.
Well, I think that they've drawn attention to a potential loophole in the Good Samaritan law that, mm-hmm. exists as it does today.
Okay.
And we did not change anything with regard to the Good Samaritan law. And technically today, under the Good Samaritan law, if a physician were to perform any services, mm-hmm. Without the consent of the person that they're performing those services for, they could be subject to criminal action.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's just part, mm-hmm. of the law as it exists today.
Right.
And I think that the doctors that opposed this law felt that that was a way to kind of try and attack it. It's unfortunate, and hopefully in the practices around the state of Florida, in all of our physician practices and hospitals, there will be a conversation about how this law does impact their ability to treat. And I'm always open to how we refine and make this product better.
Sure.
It is a new chapter of law.
Right.
And I anticipate that there will be a lot of people interested in how we can continue to strengthen parental rights in Florida.
Okay, sure. So as far as parents are concerned, what do you think parents can do now that we actually have a law on the books? And it's really a historic precedent. I mean, we have a number of states that are reaching out. I don't know if they've, mm-hmm. reached out to you, but I know our national executive director has mentioned that a number of states are reaching out and wanting to draw from what Florida has done, what you have, mm-hmm. done with the Parents' Bill of Rights. I just saw something in Michigan or Minnesota, mm-hmm. where the Attorney General there created some kind of Parents' Bill of Rights as well. So, you know, this is a historic precedent, mm-hmm. for not only our state, but for the nation. And so it's important that parents now step up and continue to get engaged, yes. because we've seen them being engaged in the last year and a half especially. How do you feel like they can make a difference in regard to this law in relationship with their children, in their communities, their city, and in their state?
Well, I think it's a great starting place for parents who might not have been engaged before,
mm-hmm.
to start to engage with their school district, mm-hmm. start to engage with just even regular private schools, mm-hmm. I believe, you know, have been paying attention to this, mm-hmm. and understanding that they need to engage with their parents in a different way too. And so continuing to be vigilant in being part of your child's life and education and not really give away. I think parents have for too long given too much responsibility, mm-hmm. to other systems in our world,
mm-hmm.
and in our country to help raise their children, and maybe have stepped back a little too much.
Right.
And so it's time that this, and I think this bill and this new law in particular really gives parents the reason to reengage in a meaningful way and in a constructive way.
Right.
I think to start the conversation maybe with their school districts,
right.
With their healthcare providers. Maybe they've never considered that their child could just walk into a healthcare provider and get certain types of treatment without their permission before.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it just opens the door to those conversations,
right.
that should have been happening before.
Right.
And of course, you know, any time that there are rights that are violated, the pathway that we have for that in this great country is for redress through our courts. And so if those entities aren't engaging in a meaningful way with parents around these conversations, unfortunately, that's the next step, but it is a step that I think parents can take and will take,
mm-hmm.
should our rights be diminished by any of those governmental entities.
Right, and it's been really incredible to see, you know, parents rising up in the last year and a half, and even more, and recognizing that their rights as parents were being violated and they didn't even realize it. So, and this law is coming into play now, and it's going to be an incredible opportunity for parents to continue to engage and to step out. Is there anything else that you would like to say about the Parents' Bill of Rights that is now law? Congratulations, by the way. This is an incredible historic thing, and we're just so grateful for you leading the legislative effort in this. And is there anything else that you'd like to say about the bill that would be helpful for parents to know here in Florida?
I would just like to thank former Representative Jennifer Sullivan, who was mm-hmm. a champion in the House before she left, my Senate sponsor, Senator Ray Rodriguez, and then, of course, Senator Stargell, who championed this legislation before, and Senator Gruters, and then my prime co-sponsor, Representative Cordbird. You know, in order to accomplish things in the legislature, we really can't operate as an individual. You need to work as a team.
Right.
And it's important for that team to reach out and explain to other members why it's so important that we move legislation like this. I want to thank families like yours and like all of the families in this community and across the state that have continued to show up and share their testimony, to reach out to all of the members in the process as this was going on, to reach out to the leadership teams in the House and the Senate, and let them know that their constituents, this matters to their constituents, that this is an important policy for them, because it's through that groundswell that we were able to accomplish this in this legislative session and get this signed into law. So I just want to say thank you.
Well, thank you. And is there, so as far as parents are concerned, what would you say to them as a parent in regard to this law moving forward?
I would say that any law, you know, we have 6 volumes of statutes today in Florida. So there's a ton of laws that are on the books, and some are obscure that people never interact with. They don't know about them. They don't know how it affects their life. And for parents' rights to continue to stay at the forefront, we all need to continue to interact with this law. We need to take our responsibilities as always as parents, you know, of the utmost importance in our life in raising our children. And we need to push back against a government who thinks that they have a greater responsibility when it comes to raising our children. And although I don't think this law is the end of that, and it's only going to be as effective as the institutions that use it in a way to proactively engage parents. So stay engaged with your family, stay engaged with every entity that interacts with your child, and ask yourself whether or not that level of interaction is appropriate and you're comfortable with, because at the end of the day, it's your comfort level that should rule today. So
Well, thank you so much, and we really appreciate all your hard work and legislative efforts, and we know you have many other things that you've been involved with and made such an impact legislatively on. And I just want to say personally, thank you to Representative Grall. She is our family's representative and with District 54, and we are so grateful that she took this and worked so hard to make this happen. And it truly was a grassroots effort behind supporting. We saw many families rise up, travel many hours to testify in these committees. And we're just so grateful for that opportunity. We wanted to also let you know that in August 28th, on a Saturday evening, we're going to have a parental rights celebration dinner in which we will be honoring Representative Grall and a number of other legislators and other people. We are so glad that the grassroots effort got involved in this movement, and we want to ask you to continue to get involved. We want to encourage you to continue to step out with your families and your parental rights, engage in your city, engage in your county, engage in your state, because parental rights, our children belong to us and not the government. And it's time, more than ever before, we have an incredible law that has been put in place. And we want to thank you for joining us tonight. We want to thank you, Representative Grall, for all your hard work.
Thank you.